Hello, good afternoon, and welcome to Book Passage's virtual stage in our series, Conversations with Authors. I'm your host, Paula Farmer. Thank you for joining us, and thank you for actively participating by putting some comments and questions, especially questions in the chat. I promise we will get to them by the kind of getting closer to the end of the program, but we love to get your comments and your questions. I am so pleased we are making doing this kind of special event for what is referred to as Holy Week with a special talk about the power of prayer and meditation with an author who has a bit of experience in the area. Although I'm usually hosting or moderating social justice related events, I have a special connection to this one through Rick, the author, Rick Hamlin's wife, Carol Wallace, who I know through my years in New York. And I actually had the honor of hosting her for her new book in March. So it's kind of a full circle moment here with the books and the family. And even silence is praise. Rick Hamlin offers stories, practical advice, and helpful prompts to guide Christians to center their minds and hearts on God as they seek to hear the still small voice above all the noise and chaos going on in the world today. Rick Hamlin has been unpacking the power of prayer in previous books such as Finding God on the A Train and 10 Prayers You Can't Live Without, and the special guidepost book, Prayer Works. In this book though, featured right behind me, you will discover how meditation has deep Christian roots, how it can be used to live more authentically and let go of anxiety, how to love more generously and find God's will in your life, and so much more. Rick Hamlin recently retired as executive editor of Guidepost Magazine, where he worked for more than 30 years, I believe. We'll ask him about that. His spiritual memoir, he had published three novels published more recently, called Reading Between the Lines, as well as The Tournament of Roses, A History of the Rose Bowl and the Rose Parade. Rick, no surprise, is a native to Pasadena, California, but now, and for a long time, has lived in New York City. Joining him in conversation is someone I think knows him pretty well, his son, Will Hamlin. Will obviously grew up in New York City, but now lives in the Bay Area, working in tech industry for Pinterest. Although Rick and Will don't always see eye to eye, I think, on spiritual matters, I think that will actually make for a great conversation, and they do have, obviously, much love and respect for each other. So with that, please join to our virtual stage, Rick and Will Hamlin.
Hey. Thank you for having us. I'm Will. This is Rick, in case you couldn't tell who's the old one, who's the young one. Excited to be here today. Dad, I enjoyed the book. And one of the things I think that's interesting about the book is it kind of does a lot of different things. So as a way to start, I would say, like, what genre or genres do you think this book is?
Wow, that's a good question.
He told me to not give him the questions in advance.
So. I didn't study up, so this is spontaneity itself. It feels there is some self-help here.
Okay.
But it also just, there's a fair amount of personal reflection. This isn't one of those books that says, do this and you'll have everything, as much as, well, I do this and it works for me sometimes, or I try this and that also works for me. That kind of self-reflection, I guess.
Okay. That was similar to my take. I had like three genres. I had like self-help, personal reflection. And then the third is there's also like a bit of like history and overarching concepts in here. So one of the things that I liked about the book that I thought was interesting is, prior to it, I'd sort of always thought about meditation and prayer as being two separate concepts. I think the book does a good job of showing how they are more interconnected. Can you talk a little bit about like how you see meditation and prayer? How do they like relate to each other?
That's an interesting question. Yeah, what my inspiration for writing this book, and I say that in the book, so if I talk about the book, you won't have to read the whole thing. But I was walking to church on the Upper West Side. I got out of the subway, and the rest of the crowd was kind of coming the other direction in their Lululemon, carrying their yoga mats. And you know, I'm a big fan of yoga. I think it's a great way of stretching, but relaxing and meditating. And I thought, wait a minute, this is also part of our Christian heritage. Why have we lost it? And I think not in every, the Quakers have a wonderful tradition of sitting there in silence, but so often in Christian traditions, we get impatient with silence. We need to fill it with talk, with sermon. You know, we have a Bible study and everybody talks, but isn't there a way to practice silence? And silence has been part of my meditative life. But this idea, meditate and prayer, the word meditate appears in the Bible all over the place. In the book of Psalms, which are all, you know, prayers, the word meditate appears 19 times. So often there, it means discursive meditation. So that means you're sort of engaging in a discussion with the heavenly, a discussion. What I feel the ultimate destination in this, and it's often called contemplation or contemplative prayer, is just letting all of that go. So in that way, now in today's language, when we use meditation, we're really thinking mostly of sort of that contemplation part of prayer, just letting it all go, just going into that mystical part where you're not overthinking anything, you're letting it go.
Okay, so let me play that back. So there's like discursive meditation, and then there's contemplative meditation, and you think that the Bible and Christianity drifted too much of a focus sort of on discursive, whereas you know, we now think of more contemplative when we think about meditation.
I don't think the Bible itself, but I think there's a wonderful tradition called Lectio Divina. This goes back to Guigo, a monk of the 12th century, if I've got it right. And Lectio Divina is about taking a passage from the Bible and meditating on it.
Okay.
And he talks about the stages of meditation, of that you read it, you pray it, you meditatio, you meditate it, and then you contemplatio, you go into this deeper state. So this discursive meditation is an avenue towards the contemplative meditation.
Got it, okay. And then when you see meditation and or yoga or what, you know, how do you perceive the meditation that yoga or that non-believers are doing? Like, how do you think that relates to the Christian tradition of it?
I mean, there's such wealth of tradition there. I think really maybe the difference is if, you know, and you meditate yourself, Will, that, you know, when you're meditating in a faith tradition, for instance, in meditation, you use that phrase to catch and release. Mm-hmm. You know how you mindfulness, you catch the thought,
yeah,
and then you release it. In a faith practice, you're releasing it to the divine. You're letting it go to where God can take care of it.
Mm, yeah. Whereas when I do it, when I'm doing like my calm app 10-minute meditations, I just kind of release it into the ether, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay, and so yeah, let's get into some of the personal reflection then. Yeah, tell us and tell the audience what is your personal meditation practice?
Well, one of the things that I say is that when you do a practice like this, what's really important is to do it every day, because when it becomes a habit like that, you can fall into it easier. So not only every day, but also to have a regular place you go to, because that place It's just like, you know, you sit at your desk and you work on your laptop. It says, oh, let's work, work, work. It's time to work. You know, if you go to this chair, and for me in our old New York apartment, it's the lumpy sofa, okay. You know, and I go and sit there first thing in the morning. And for me, half an hour, I'm really lucky to be able to have half an hour to do it. But if you had only 5 minutes a day, doing it every day, it's going to have more significance to you, is a return practice again and again and again.
Got it.
And it's, I think, almost also easier if you do it at the same time of the day. What we always hear and we know so well in our lives is, gosh, I don't really have time. I think a long dedicated practice, it helps you prioritize so that you can let go of some of those things. Oh, I really got to do that. I got to do that. I got to do that. If you do it for every day over a long period of time.
Okay. Yeah. And that's, I think, so for the audience, I'm an atheist. I'm was raised Christian and left the faith, but my meditation practice when I have one is very similar to that. It's first thing in the morning in our house. I get some coffee beforehand, which is maybe cheating, maybe not, I don't know. And then I use one of those apps. So I've used both Headspace and Calm, but the consistency of doing it every day, and then the consistency of having it be first thing in the morning. Because if I tried to do it later in the day, then I try, but then A, it's hard to schedule, and B, my mind is racing too much already. And so it's most helpful when I feel like it's kind of calm at the beginning of the day. Okay, so you do it 30 minutes every morning. How do you know when to stop?
Isn't that interesting? You know, I don't set a timer. And I should admit, you know, during that period, I'm not just in this blissful calm. You know, the distractions appear. And everybody gets really wildly, you know, oh, the distractions. My mind's so distracted. You know, when I talk to people about meditation, they'll say, oh, I try it, but I get too distracted. And I always want to scream and say, well, that's the whole point. You get to hear the distractions. You pay attention. You know, when the distractions turn up, you don't then get out your phone and make that text or get out your computer and send that email. You hear it. You catch, you release. And, you know, some people can just kind of close their eyes partially. I close them all the way. And then I open my eyes and I look down and I sometimes think, oh my gosh, I've been here for hours. Oh, it's only 28 minutes. Or, God, I haven't been here for it all. Oh, it was 29 minutes. Your body kind of knows, okay.
You don't cheat. You're like, you know, you're like, before I used the apps, I tried to do it this way. And yeah, I would like, look, I'd be like, it was 5 minutes, you know?
Well, but that's amazing when you think of how much went on in those five.
Yeah, minutes. That's true. Yeah.
You know, but what's really important is in that period, you're only doing that. I mean, if it means you have to put your phone in the other room, put the phone in the other room. I think this is a way why it's so important in our era. When you think back to biblical times, they didn't have their phones interrupting them all the time. They didn't have these wonderful things we call computers, you know, they can communicate with email. I love those things, but it's important to step away from them to hear where your mind is. You become less distractible by doing that.
Okay. And, you know, atheist or non-believer question. So where does God feature in all this? You know, like, do you think about God when you're meditating, or is this, how does that relate to then the kind of the faith-based part?
Well, here's you know, this is a Holy Week period. And one of the things in the Holy Week story is, what did they find first? They found the empty tomb, you know, and notice too, in the Holy Week story, here's the sermon. It's all right. It was the women who stuck around for the worst part of it. The disciples all went away, but the women were there when he was crucified. And who were the first ones to see the resurrected Jesus, the women. So that to me says, you stick through the hard stuff, and you know what hard stuff we've been through. You have this more chance of being there for the illumination. So what I look for in this is these little moments of illumination. They're not huge. They're not every day. Mm-hmm. But it's peace. The peace of God, the peace that passes all understanding. You know, what we want to do is understand. But there is this other thing, wow, that passes all understanding.
Okay. And do you find that those moments of illumination, do those occur while you're meditating, later in the day because you were meditating, or maybe not? I don't know, like, or both?
You might just get a hint of it, or you might have thought, oh, well, I didn't do anything. I didn't have anything. And then it'll occur to you later during the day. Oh, yeah. You will remember from Sunday school. I was also a Sunday school teacher. So you see how well I did.
Lucky guy over here.
There we talk about Paul uses the phrase to pray without ceasing. That doesn't mean I'm praying, okay, Jesus Christ, you know, I think that means to live prayerfully, to live in the present moment, to honor the love that's here, to be aware of the beauty that's here. So how do you do that? Well, by sort of putting the jumble of my day right there at the beginning in half an hour of meditation, the rest of the day, I can sort of say, oh God, yeah, this is that thing that I was really worried about, the checkbook balancing, the article I have to write, the interview I have to make. You know, wait, I sort of put that into God's hands early in my day. So, all right, guess what? God's here.
Yeah, well, and I think what alienates a lot of non-believers like me is why you still see us flocking to things like meditation apps and yoga is the Christian message has come across as being very literal. And so prayer is, you know, Jesus Christ, you know, like, and things like that. And God is, you know, old dude with beard reaching out, trying to touch Adam in the Sistine Chapel. Whereas I think what's appealing about, and what you go do a good job of explaining in the book is, you know, God is small moments of delight, and God is being present when you're with your 4-month-old grandchild and things like that. And similarly, meditation is a way to connect to those moments.
Yeah.
I mean, I think when I find one thing that is always amazing to me when I meditate is how quickly my brain is moving, and just how much, and not like that, and not necessarily productively, it just bounces from thing to thing to thing to thing. And I'm like, oh my God, am I always this all over the place? You know? And then it kind of, so I become more aware of that than the rest of the day.
Yeah, awareness is really valuable. I mean, from any faith tradition or non-faith, to be aware, mindfulness, how my mind is operating. Jesus said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength. Isn't that interesting? We often forget the mind part, but a meditation practice is being aware of where the mind is going.
Meditation is also about confronting some of the harder aspects of life. I want to read some chapter titles. Chapter 4, listen to your anger. Chapter 5, hear the worries. Chapter 6 is more mild, just try praying and you'll be doing it. Chapter 7, focus on death. Anger, worries, death, fun stuff. But obviously very important things. Yeah, I'd love to hear about how you feel meditation has been helpful for you to work through some of the challenges of life.
I have something I call, and I mentioned in the book, the irritation index, you know, things that kind of irritate you. And in the Bible, just say, you know, do not go to bed. Let go of your anger before you go to sleep.
Is that in the Bible?
Yeah. Okay. I'm terrible at quoting the Bible unless it's part of a song or a hymn, and then I could pull up with it. But we're, of course we have these feelings. Of course we get anger and irritation. If you ignore them, they only get bigger. You know, I mean, this is so much the gift of talk therapy. You know, we talk through our anger. We talk through what irritates us, and irritation, I think, is a kind of anger. The biggest, emotions. Some people say there's really two main emotions in the world: fear and love. And the Bible makes this point, you know, perfect love casts out fear, the huge contrast. So sometimes what is at the bottom of anger is fear. We have these huge fears. So, you know, Jesus frequently said, God frequently said, be not afraid, be not afraid. That doesn't mean don't do that. That means, hey, I'm here with you. You don't have to be there. Because fear can just push you and drive your life. So in some prayer practice, to be aware of your fears, don't ignore them, being aware of them, and then living in love, not fear.
And so, you know, what happens when you come across fear in meditation? What do you do?
You notice it. You have to admit it. You have to notice it.
Can you use an example, maybe to.
Well, let's look at the fear of death. Our culture works very, very hard at ignoring death. I so often the phrase is someone passed. It feels more polite, so they passed rather than died. Mm-hmm. And I think that's kind of a reflection of our culture's, you know, avoidance of it. And fortunately, we live in an era when people live much longer, which is a real blessing. But the truth of the matter is, we're going to die. So to be aware of that is also to be able to remember the big John Wooden, I think, the basketball coach at UCLA, John Wooden had this great phrase. He said, make each day your masterpiece. So to be aware of the shortness of life, the brevity of life, is to be able to honor the day, to see how precious it is.
That's powerful and a bit intimidating. So
intimidating for me too.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'd love to get to some of the more self-help aspects of it for those in the audience who are interested. Yeah, I guess where would you tell people to start if they wanted to build a meditation practice?
I'm going to go into, you know, if in a faith-based meditation practice, we use the word mantras in our Eastern tradition. There's a wonderful anonymous author, 14th century, as I remember, probably a monk, who wrote a book called The Cloud of Unknowing. It's in Middle English. And don't you love that? Unknowing, The Cloud of Unknowing. And in this unknowing, he recommends using a single word to focus, so that, you know, as the distractions come into your mind, you're sitting there on your lumpy sofa or wherever you sit in a chair. Often the recommendation is with your feet on the floor, or so that you're sort of rising up from the ground, but is to use a single word to keep yourself focused. He even goes so far as to say a single syllable word, like God, peace, love, sin. But to just keep that to circle back. There are also other one. Yeah.
What's
yeah.
funny about that is, and this is the, you know, shows distractibility, right? As you started going through that, I was like, okay, I was thinking about the single words. And then once you said three, I was like, it became like a Scrabble game. I needed to think of as many single syllable words as possible. I was like, pear, you know, glass. Anyway.
That's good. It's good.
I think probably better meditate on peace than on pears.
On peace than pears. You know, the scientists, you know, have often tried to do some research on the power of prayer. And one of the real problems is, how do you have a control group? Let's say, you know, you're going to be praying for these patients, but not praying for these patients. Well, anybody who's a praying person is going to pray for anybody who needs it. You're not going to say, oh, I'm not going to pray for that half of the room. So it's very, very hard to do any sort of tests on scientific prayer. But one of the things, I'm wondering here, but one of the things they found out is that people from faith traditions are more likely to stick with it. So to stick with a prayer practice, because it's part of your faith tradition. Or maybe you have a community that you do it with. But yes, of course the mind is distractible. That's also one of the gifts of our minds. You know, when you and I talk, you constantly have to remind you, wait, Dad, you've changed the subject. Go back to where you were. So that's the mind that keeps moving.
That happens occasionally. Okay, so tips are have a consistent practice, just be consistent about it.
Same place. Yeah.
One tactic is starting with a single word, meditating on that word.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
There's also breathing.
Yep.
I know, which is, yeah, sometimes, you know, breathing in, you know, Jesus Christ, have mercy upon me, Jesus. Breathing in, breathing out, or just, you know, breathing in love, breathing it out, you know, to use a word like that, and the practice of breath, not counting the breath. You know, you count in, you know, 5 seconds inhale, hold for 7 seconds, exhale. I mean, you know, there's the that kind of practice. But I think sometimes just, you know, breathing in on a word and breathing out. I don't know if I've mentioned also, no, I haven't, holding an image in your head. We haven't talked about this, but that's a big tradition in the Eastern Church, icons, you know, looking at an icon and holding that in your head while you stare at it, but also just closing your eyes and holding an image. I love the dogs outside. That would be happening in your prayer life. You know, you're sitting there and you go, uh-oh, I hear the dogs outside. Okay, the dogs will be okay. I'll let them in 20 minutes. but the an image can help you keep focused. Sometimes just an image of nature, a tree. And you can't hold on to an image for, my experience is about 20 seconds. Okay. And then it moves to another image. So move to the flower, the cloud, whatever's next.
Okay. One of the things that's fun about the book is at the end of every chapter, there's a meditative moment. You shared a couple of them here, focusing on a word, focusing on an image. I was looking through them before preparing for this. And I think my favorite is the 5 senses one. Where it's you can do this even for 30 seconds each, and spend 30 seconds each on like one sense. The taste is the hardest one to probably do, but you know, you just focus on what you can see, and you kind of try to isolate that sense, and you realize how rarely we do that. And this is something that I've personally, I'm particularly aware of because I have a 4-month-old baby, and all he is doing right now is figuring out his senses, looking around the world, you know, like, you know, touching things. He's now starting to try to bite and eat everything, right? And that's, we were all 4 months old at one point. And I think the experience of narrowing to a single sense, focusing on that sense, I find I always see something or hear something or feel something that I wasn't expecting before.
Yeah.
What are, as you've been, as you were working on this, or as, and just in your meditation and prayer journey, what other books or podcasts or things have been helpful to you? Obviously, this one is the most important that you should buy, but if there was, what other things have been helpful to you as you...
You know, I'm hardly original, and that's wonderful to be able to say that. There's some modern writer, Cynthia Bourgeau, is wonderful. The whole idea of centering prayer, that's a more recent, you know, kind of way for people in the Christian faith to pull down this meditative practice, contemplative prayer. Martin Laird is a wonderful writer. He writes about this. One of the things he talks about in this practice is the reactive mind versus the receptive mind. Okay. I mean, that would be, you know, helpful for you, you know, in a meditative practice. It's to get to the receptive mind. You're not going, oh God, that makes me so mad, or oh God, I don't want to do that. It's, oh, that's what she's saying. Oh, receptive. Anyway, Martin Laird's wonderful, Cynthia Bourgeau. And there's a lot of great writers out there.
Okay.
And those are contemporary.
And then can you talk a little about these things? Devices. The book talks about how that is challenging from a meditation practice. How do you kind of think about the interplay between our technology and
I think we have to remember, you know, that they are, of course, a gift, but that they're challenging to any sort of life practice. I was listening to a British scientist. I'm sorry, I don't remember his name, but, you know, in his work, he leaves his phone in the mornings in the other room for 5 hours. I remember I left my phone at the office one day and I was without it for like 14 hours. I couldn't check the weather. There's so many things I couldn't do. I couldn't text. What if somebody was trying to text me? But it's a reminder that they can be more controlling of our lives than we really want. Mm-hmm. I mean, technology is a gift, but remember, we're the boss. The phone is not the boss. The computer is not the boss. You know, you're the one who controls it. So if it means putting your phone in another room for 5 hours, do that, you know. Your notifications. Be aggressive with your notifications. You do not need to be notified of every email. Or maybe there's just a couple sources of email you need to be notified of. I'm very restrictive in my notifications. I get all of your texts.
That's good. I'm glad that I make it through the filter. Makes sense, but what does that have to do with meditation?
What it is it's about mindfulness. It's about really being careful about what's filling your mind. And this practice of doing it day after day, it's to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. It's being able to focus your mind, you know, the big things of life, not the little screwy things, but the big things of life.
Okay. So I think final question, and then we might have some questions from the audience. Nice. So I guess how would you, so it sounds like same time, same place, build a practice, just do it regularly. A few exercises that are in here, including thinking about an image, thinking about an English word, thinking about your senses.
Yeah.
Breathing, focusing your breath. Any other tips that you'd share?
You know, you can go for a prayer walk, which means for me, no podcasts, Rick. Take the podcast off, you know, and you enjoy the creation, which is a way to connect to the creator. You look at the tree in a different way when you're just there to look at the tree. That can be a completely meditative practice.
Cool. Lots of options. I think the questions are going to come.
Okay, great. Said, yeah.
In the chat window. So let me open this up.
Oh, wow. Can you read them?
I can read them.
My eyes are not small enough.
All right.
Need them.
We'll just, let me see if I can group. I'll just go chronologically. Well, sure. Let's do the simplest. Ryan asks, what is Maundy Thursday?
Ah, Monday, Thursday, this is the day of this in Holy Week, this is the day of the Last Supper. So they prepare a meal and Jesus blesses the bread and the wine. And there's also this lovely thing that happens in this moment where Jesus washes the feet of his disciple. And think about in those days how dirty the feet must have gotten. But it's about servanthood. It's how to be a real leader. This guy's, you know, the Son of God. And what is he doing? He's lowering himself and washing the feet. So that's a lovely practice.
Okay. I'm not gonna wash your feet.
That's okay. But I wash your feet. That's the whole point. I wash your feet.
Not in quite some time.
not since you were your baby's age.
No. All right, Kathy asks, that's a great question. Do you think meditation is best being completely separate from exercise?
It's a good question, Kathy. I've heard people say, oh, when I run, I go on a meditation. Truth to tell, when I go on for a run, I cannot meditate because I'm thinking, I'm going to have to go up that hill. I might be getting to, endorphin lifts, but it's not meditation. I think walking, I think you can do something in terms of meditation because you can let go of your anxiety. But so I think a high impact sort of aerobics or any of that stuff that might be really good for you, it's harder for me to use as meditation practice.
What about yoga?
Sure. I mean, that's what it's there. If you like to do yoga online, yoga with Adrian, it's less possible there because I'm listening to a voice. But if you take some of those positions and do them with breath technique, of course, you can log on. You can check out to check in.
Okay. Question for Will. Was there a time when you were a believer, or were you always skeptical? If so, what was it like growing up with a deeply spiritual father agreeing to disagree? Good question. I was a believer until I was about 16. Then I lost my faith. And what was it like growing up with a deeply spiritual father? I'm the outlier in the house. My other brother is in seminary right now, in training to become a priest. I think it's makes for interesting conversations. I think that I have I appreciate that I've gotten to experience both being a believer and being a non-believer. I think a lot of people who've never grown up with faith ignore a lot of the benefits of it and are sort of focused most on the very visible sort of extreme negative examples like Spanish Inquisition or the Taliban. So I appreciated growing up in a Christian household, although it is not the household I live in anymore.
You know, one of the practices in our household, we did grace every night, said grace before dinner, and we still do it. Praying, you're praying to something. You might not be a believer in God, but you do have a spiritual side.
Yeah. So, well, I think that a lot of atheists neglect, get snobby and neglect the fact that religion is clearly solving a basic human need. And a lot of the practices of Christianity, I think, are great. I mean, I think meditation is great. At dinner every night, we do cheers. Even if we're not drinking, even if we just have two glasses of water, we'll still cheers. Like the practice of coming together and like focusing on the meal is kind of a similar idea as saying grace. So I think Christianity has a lot to offer. I think that a lot of atheists sort of neglect that. Who are some writers that influence you personally? I think I mostly asked that one. Nancy asks, is this conversation difficult for the two of you to have together since your meditation practices differ?
Will, you can answer that. It doesn't feel difficult to me because you're so present. And because I love you and I love who you are.
Thanks, Ed. I think it's difficult because it's just like, a little awkward to like interview my dad.
that's
difficult. But no, I think that we respect each other's faith practices. And again, and the book gets this, but like, I think there's more overlap as, you know, in a lot of the how, even if the why and how we come to those practices differ.
I think it's really important for people of faith to listen to people who are not of faith.
And vice versa.
That the world, I mean, there's some reason that Jesus said, love your enemies, huh? But we can, you know, make people so other that we can't even hear who they are. If it's your son, it's easy, but I'm trying to be open as possible to love all.
And then last question, Ariel says, love the book title. Wonder if there was an experience coming through meditation that was its origin.
Oh, thank you. That, you know, titles, I'm so lousy at titles. The title, Even Silence is Praise, actually comes from a translation of one of the Psalms, Psalm 65, I think. To you, God, even silence is praise. But just this whole idea of praise, I mean, you start to think, well, God, are you so insecure that you need everybody to praise you? You know, how in work environments, you know, you learn how to, you know, praise people, thank them for what they did, appreciate what they did. And this whole faith practice of praise, it's not for God, it's for us. It's just living in a time of, be in a space of thankfulness. So even silence is praise is sort of my spiritual goal and my journey. And one that, you know, I get to practice every morning when I sit on the lumpy sofa.
We have one more question. Sorry, Paula. Coming in, Molly asks, speaking of brothers, my two sons are on opposite sides of the faith continuum. They are not close now at ages 20 and 24. Did you find that you got closer to your brother later in life? A couple of thoughts about that. I think that to potentially gender stereotype, brothers and men in general often have different ways of being close. For example, my brother traveled internationally for 5 months when he was 22, graduated from college, and we did not talk literally the entire time, but I felt like we stayed close the entire time. I think that we've always gotten along relatively well, and I think we've gotten closer as we've gotten older. I think we got close, probably we overlapped for a year in college, and that was a big moment. And then, as we've just learned to become adults, we've gotten closer. So we've gotten closer, we've gotten older, and hopefully if you want that is the case for your sons too.
This was really good. Thank you both. I thought very interesting. I'm to be perfectly honest, more interesting than I thought. Because I tend to be more like, well, not as much into my faith or sense of spirituality. But this was really enlightening. I thank you, Rick, for making it very accessible and practical. I had a lot out of it, so I'm sure there are a lot of other people who did too. Obviously, we had a lot of questions, so people were engaged.
Well, it was me who drafted Will to do this, so thank you, Will. But I see him as representative of San Francisco since he lives here.
Good dynamic. Yeah. And Will, you did great for being uncomfortable going into it. You did great. You both did great. I just want to thank the audience for coming, whether you came and are here live. We also put this up on our YouTube channel, so people obviously will be seeing it later. And we appreciate our audience that comes in the recording as well. I want to remind everybody that this is the featured book. I don't know Yeah, it's, by the way, beautiful cover. I don't know if you signed off on it or had any input, but it's really beautiful. And I want people to recognize that it's actually in paperback. It was released in paperback, right?
Yeah, it was, yeah. And, you know, my wife, Carol, who's the aesthetic expert in the household, we had like three alternates. And she said, oh, yes, go with this, honey.
Yeah. Good call, Carol. But I think people are appreciating that a lot of books now, not a lot, but some at least, are getting released in paperback. I think obviously that makes it more accessible, more affordable. People are getting back to traveling, so no excuse not to just have it with you and travel easily. And obviously there's some environmental positive impact with that too. So I'm always like, yay, it was released in paperback. And we do have Rick's book in both our stores, Corte Madera and San Francisco locations. You can come in and buy it and buy other books. You can order online. You can give us a call. We're happy to take your order and get it fulfilled. And also wanted to remind everybody that if you're watching this and you're not subscribed, it really only takes you like a couple minutes, not even a minute, a few seconds to subscribe. And it really helps Book Passage a lot in our YouTube channel. So please be sure and do that, like and subscribe, as they say. And also good time to remind people we have yet another event coming up today. It's for this fascinating, fantastic collection of short stories called Small Odysseys, also released in paperback, with 35, I think over 35, very kind of larger than life, highbrow, however you want to put it, greatly admired writers contributing to it, including Weeki Wang. We just had her on the program not that long ago, Dave Eggers, Michael Cunningham. So join us at 5:30 Pacific time. We'll talk to the editor and a few of the contributors. For now, thanks to our guests today, Rick and Will Hamlin. Buy the book and start meditating, get consistent. That was my takeaway. Am I right?
And I signed a couple of copies of the book too.
Yes, so we do have signed ones, and we do have book plates as well.
Yeah, so
here's your chance to get a rare signed book by Rick Hamlin. And we really appreciate you going into the store and signing it during your travels out west. Thank you again to the audience, to Will, Carol, for helping me connect with you and make this happen during Holy Week. Really appreciate it. Safe travels to you all, to all of you. Thanks again to our audience. Come back again later tonight.
Thanks, Paula.
Thanks, everybody.
Mm-hmm.